Grace to you and peace in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and welcome to Bethany on this, the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. Isn't it lovely to have a change in the air and the crisper? It just feels wonderful. And this is the last Sunday of summer. Next Sunday, we will officially be in fall. So thanks be to God, we've got a taste, a foretaste, if you will, of the grace and goodness that is to come. Before we get started, I wanted to point this out. I had a gift in my chair this morning. I didn't know who to attribute it to. And then Belton informed me that he had been at a pastor's meeting. Is that right? Clergy retreat? Retiree retreat, right? And someone had made these, hand-carved them, and it has a little string on it, so I can wear it as a necklace, and said for the each attendee to take one and give it to their pastor. So I love it. It has this little stand to sit on. It's gorgeous. Please stand as you are able and join in our call to worship. Children of God, when we have been wounded by another or others, we turn to God and ask, how many times must I forgive? When Jesus answers that we must forgive again and again and again, we are tempted to ask again, how many times must I forgive? It's only when we hear God asking us, how many times have I forgiven you, that we understand the need for endless forgiveness. 70 times 7. How many times have I loved you? 70 times 7. How many times has my grace been sufficient for you? 70 times 7. Let us humble ourselves and learn how to forgive, not from our own power or resources, but from God's, who forgives us so that we may learn to live well with one another. Let us praise God, who generously forgives us so that we may forgive one another. Our opening hymn is number 127, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah.
Thank you. remain standing and join in our opening prayer. Creator God, our source and our salvation, in love you made us, and by love you have redeemed us. Make your love for us bear fruit in our forgiveness of others, that in this life we may know your all-embracing compassion, and in the world to come, receive the everlasting joy of the fellowship you share with your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For illumination prior to our scripture readings. Guide us, O God, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth we may find wisdom, and in your will discover your peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all God's people said, Amen. The epistle lesson is found in Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel found in Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Right. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I have a reminder on my computer that it is my mother-in-law's birthday today. It won't go away. Okay. Technology. We had technology troubles last night at the football game, too. Fifth or sixth time, the charm. All right. Here we go. Whew. Pray with me, please. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Breathe your loving kindness into our hearts so that we are able to hear with joy the word you have for us this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're talking about forgiving today, and let's go ahead and admit up front that forgiving is hard. Not for the little slights, the occasional emotional bumps and bruises. No, but if someone has really hurt us or wronged us, all too often our first instinct is to want justice, right? Some kind of payback. We might even want to give that person a taste of their own medicine. For the deepest wounds, we often just completely reject the idea of forgiveness outright, because we think of forgiveness as letting the perpetrator get away with their sins, their misdeed, their crime. That's not justice. They should pay, we cry. We may think of forgiveness as leniency, or worse, wimpiness, as though our forgiveness of someone reflects badly on us. Last week, I talked about perspective, about seeing through God's eyes, about walking in God's good world differently because we have been shown a glimpse of what it could be, what God wants the world to be in the life and love and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. And you know, that's what Christianity is, really. It's cultivating the mind of Christ, right? Living with a Christ-like perspective, living the love of Jesus in the world, in this messy, unfair world, accepting that we might be thought of as fools, but choosing anyway to live that grace-giving, loving, forgiving life, because we know, because of Jesus, that that is the better way to live. It's God's way to live. Not all pious and holier than thou, but graciously and generously welcoming and forgiving and loving all the people. So turning our attention to today's text, when Peter asked Jesus how many times we have to forgive others, Jesus said 77 times. Now, I know that we know, because I've said it from the pulpit before, but you all already knew this. Jesus knew his scripture. Jesus was raised on it. And Jewish boys had to memorize their scripture because the actual Torah, the physical scripture they had, was off limits to everyone except for the priests. So for this next little bit of biblical insight, I'm indebted to the Salt Project, their reflection on this text this week. So when Jesus told Peter to forgive 77 times, he was reminding Peter of the heritage of Cain, recorded in Genesis 4. Cain's great-great-great-grandson, Lamech, promised his wives that, quote, if Cain is avenged sevenfold, truly Lamech 77-fold. Lamech intended to continue the violence that began when Cain slew Abel. 77-fold. So when Jesus said you have to forgive, he was referencing the evil that comes from that different mindset. It's revenge, right? Avenging our hurts. It killed me to say that in the sermon because I'm a fan of the Avengers and all those Marvel movies, but that's good fiction, right? Because they can do the things that I will not do. We want revenge. It is the mindset of the Hatfields and the McCoys. If you hurt me, I'm going to hurt you back twice as hard, right? But we know in our hearts that this kind of thinking does not work. As Gandhi said, an eye for an eye only ends up making the whole world blind. And the answer, as Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, the answer is hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Love, forgiveness, it's the better way. It's the way of Jesus. It's a commitment to a quality of mind, the mind of Jesus, if you will, that shapes our interactions. It's the only way that will truly transform the world. And it's tough. Forgiveness demands of us that we set aside our need for payback in favor of nurturing and strengthening our relationships. Now, you've probably heard this before, maybe even from me, but for the purposes of our scripture, let me remind you that a denarius was a day's wage. A day's wage was the amount of money that was needed to live on for one day. And that's a fair trade. A day's labor in exchange for the amount of money needed to supply the day's needs. Some people make more than that, obviously, but no one should make less than that. And that's our lesson within the lesson for today. We shouldn't expect anyone to trade a day of their labor for less than enough money to provide for that day's needs. That cannot but lead to endless poverty. It is unjust. And we, the church, need to proclaim that loud and clear. So a denarius was a day's wage. A talent, on the other hand, was roughly equivalent to 6,000 denarii. So working 50 weeks a year, 5 days a week, which is a modern work schedule, a talent would equal about 12 years of work. And the merciless manager that we read about owed 10,000 talents, about 120,000 years of labor, an unpayable debt, a sum so huge it was unthinkable. Which is the point. We have to remember that Jesus often taught using hyperbole, exaggerated numbers, numbers so huge that they were instantly understood as a means to make a point and not a real life calculation. So, getting back to the scripture, our king's first instinct was to throw the man who had this insurmountable debt into prison, along with his entire family. All of them were going to go into the work prisons to spend the rest of their lives working off a debt, which even with that amount of people working for those many years would not be repaid. But that man pleaded for lenience. Have patience with me and I will repay you everything. I mean, we can ask, was he lying? Was he delusional? Already planning to demand full payment from everyone who owed him anything at all? It doesn't matter. This is hyperbole. These are big numbers. But that's not the point. The king, out of pity for the man, released him and forgave him the debt. So the king forgave the unforgivable. He showed unexpected and really inexplicable compassion. In a word, he showed grace. Grace. Now, we're also not told why that man who had received this amazing gift of grace then turned around and demanded that the servant who owed him 100 denarii, why he demanded payment in full for that considerably smaller debt. It was sizable to the man working for the day's wage, but it could be repaid over time. And did you notice that the second man pleaded for lenience using the exact same words that the first man said? Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. But the merciless manager, unlike the king, would not have patience, did not have any pity, and instead had the man who owed him money thrown into prison, which really is kind of an unusual way to think of having somebody repay you. They can't work from prison. You can't repay the debt that way. But we can be blind like that too, right? We can be blind to our blessings and blind to our lack of grace for others. In fact, many of us miss the way Scripture convicts us in our hearts because we're too busy thinking about someone we know who really should hear this text, who really need to hear this story. And Jesus, thanks be to God, understood that about us. And it's probably why he told us to pray, forgive us our sins, our debts, our trespasses, as we forgive those who sin or trespass or against us or owe us anything. Because none of us is blameless before the Lord on our own account. Friends, you know this. It is God's grace alone in Christ Jesus that is our salvation and our hope. Now, Jesus began this parable on forgiveness by saying the kingdom of heaven is, or may be compared to, this whole situation with the debts that were owed and forgiven or not forgiven. And we need to remind ourselves that we would be the ones carrying the unpayable debt were it not for the grace of God in Jesus Christ. Grace that is given to us, which is profligate, nonsensical, and frankly unjust, at least as we understand justice. We are forgiven unforgivable debts. God's grace and forgiveness is given to us even though we don't deserve it, and it is given to others who, in our opinion, shouldn't receive it. And that's where we get angry, right? That's not just. Just remember, it's not just for us either. And frankly, I give thanks to God that that is true, because it is entirely likely that we are on someone's undeserving of grace list, right? Someone thinks we don't deserve it. And our Romans text reminds us, who are you to pass judgment on slaves of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld. They will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. This is God's purview, not ours. Jesus concluded his parable with one of his more difficult statements for us to hear. The unforgiving servant, the recipient of the king's generous grace, failed to offer that same grace to the one who owed him money, so the king handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So, tortured indefinitely, right? Because one, we can't work to be paid to satisfy a debt while we're being tortured. And two, Jesus already made it clear that the debt could not be repaid. And the lesson for us is that this agony of endless torture will be ours as well if we do not forgive our brother or sister from our heart. I said at the start, forgiveness is hard. Forgiveness, friends, is hard, but that is our task, to soften our hearts so that we may forgive one another. Lots of churches are destroyed from within because disagreements happen, and they always do, because whenever two or more are gathered together, there will be disagreements. Ask any married couple. In churches, factions arise. People take sides, and forgiveness is never offered. Or if it is offered, it's refused. The grudge remains. The bitterness remains. The unity of the community is compromised. Forgiveness isn't optional for us as Christians. It is difficult. And in my experience, forgiveness is usually a process. We make a decision that we are going to forgive someone. And then when that resentment rears its ugly head again, and it will, we have to forgive again and again, until we have finally and truly forgiven from our heart. And friends, it's probably more than 70 times 7. Forgiving those who have wronged us, whether it's 77 times or a million, it doesn't matter. Forgiving as many times as it takes to free our own hearts. This is critical. Forgiveness frees our own hearts from that resentment. It frees us to love and have compassion for one another. And that's how we strengthen the body of Christ. Friends, it's how we participate with God in establishing the reign of God come upon this earth. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, all God's people say, Amen. Our hymn of response is number 121, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy. If you will, in your hymnal to number 889, the affirmation from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 and 6, chapter 1, 15, and chapter 3, 16. There is one God, and there is one mediator, Christ Jesus, who came as a ransom for all, to whom we testify. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, and was manifested in the flesh, vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in throughout the world, taken up in glory. Great indeed is the mystery of the gospel. Amen. You may be seated. We come now to a time of sharing our joys and concerns. I want to mention again that these gorgeous flowers are from Miles Kern's funeral a week ago yesterday, and they still look amazing. And we are grateful to the Kern's family for leaving them here for us. Are there joys and concerns? Yes.
Yes, concern. So, announcements, I guess, more than anything else. Sorry. So, September is, Bethany is collecting socks and underwear for men and women that goes to Urban Ministry. You can put it in the back of the Narthex. This Saturday is Durham Pride at 10:30. The parade starts on Duke East Campus. The next day, there is a worship service called Queerly Beloved at 5 p.m. at Duke Memorial, with a reception to follow. And then also this week on Tuesday, we have Vital Conversation, which is our anti-racism group, 7 o'clock on Zoom. And then also Thursday evening is our church council. Everyone is open, invited to attend.
April and I have some good news. Our oldest nephew was so excited to let us know that him and his wife are expecting.
Oh. Yay!
They are 2 months along.
Yeah. If there are no others, let us go to God in prayer. Gracious and merciful God, we are grateful that you are merciful. We are grateful that you are forgiving. We are grateful for the many ways that you bless us daily. And we ask your forgiveness when we do not acknowledge the wonderful gifts that you lay before us each and every day. Help us to remember to be appreciative of your blessings. Help us to remember to thank you when we experience a moment of your glory in our day. Lord, we pray for communities who are suffering. We've experienced devastating damage from earthquakes and floods and fires and wind. Just feels like everywhere and every day some community is reeling from another catastrophe that's weather related. These things scare us, especially because we have no control over the weather. We have no control over whether or not we will be in harm's way. We pray that our response to those who are in need will come from the heart and from your compassion, as we remember that we are in fact your hands and feet upon this earth. Help us to do the things that we should do to make life good for all the people. We can start in our own communities, our own neighborhoods, our own homes even. But help us to see with your eyes and to extend your compassion in all the ways that we can. Lord, we pray especially for people in our faith community who are suffering illness, loss, fear, the unknown. We know that we are not alone. Lord, you are available to us in every moment, but sometimes we forget. We forget to take the time to sit with you and allow your love to heal us, to enlighten us, to guide us. We pray, Lord, for faith to hold on, even when we're holding on by a thread. We pray for faith to learn from our experiences so that we may help others who are experiencing similar things, similar parts of their life's journey. Lord, we ask your blessing upon our church family that we may grow in love and faith, that we may nurture one another in love and faith, and that we may be a community of forgiveness and welcome for all people everywhere. That our behavior, not just here on our church's campus, but everywhere we go, is an invitation to join us in learning how to love and serve you better every day of our lives. Lord, we understand that we have much to learn in our faith journey, and we commit ourselves to learning to love as Jesus loves, learning to forgive as Jesus has forgiven. And to this end, we pray the prayer that Jesus gave to his disciples and us, saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the Lord is gracious and merciful, ever ready to forgive us, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Confident that God forgives us when we humbly confess our sin, let us pray together. God of mercy and love, you have given birth to our world, conceiving and bearing all lives and breathes. We come to you as your daughters and sons, aware of our aggression and anger, confessing our drive to dominate, win, and manipulate others. We ask you to forgive us. knowing that we must also forgive those who have wronged us in any way, surrendering our own carefully chronicled list of grievances to your wisdom and care, recognizing that your generous, profligate forgiveness may benefit those we'd prefer to see punished. Pour out your Spirit upon us, that our hearts may be softened and our eyes open to the joy of forgiving our enemies. Help us to lighten our hearts by surrendering our grievances, that we may find our compassion for others renewed and expanded. May the light of your forgiveness shine upon us so that we may be vessels of your forgiving light in the world. Friends, hear this good news. The Lord God is merciful and gracious, endlessly patient, loving, and true, showing mercy to all who call upon his holy name, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin, and granting pardon. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Now, as we have said and sung and heard the word proclaimed, I invite you to respond with generosity in your gifts and in God's tithes. Thank you. merciful God, we give you thanks for the many ways that you bless us, chief among them, your forgiveness and grace. We pray that these, our financial gifts, will be pleasing in your sight, and that you may multiply their impact in bringing your kingdom come upon the earth. Amen. Our final hymn is number 560, Help Us Accept Each Other. Now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest upon you and abide within you this day. And may you go forth from this time of worship nourished in your spirit to love and serve the Lord. Amen.